One of the great surprises since the 1980s has been how active the outer solar system is. In 1989, Voyager 2 completed its grand tour of the giant planets with a flyby of Neptune. Neptune itself was a surprise in those days, sporting weather systems and its own giant spot that happened to be raging just when the spacecraft passed by. But also in this amazing flyby was our first look at Neptune's moon, Triton, which before this flyby was envisioned as a frozen, icy wasteland. Instead, multiple cryo geysers were seen lofting material in a sort of analog of hot water geysers here on Earth. This has led to the study of low temperature action by volatiles, such as water melting in the outer solar system bodies, the heat for which is linked to the radioactive decay of materials in the cores of these worlds, where water and other volatiles can act as an analog of lava and volcanism here on Earth. Termed cryovolcanism, along with the aforementioned cryo geysers, this leads to a surprising amount of low temperature activity in the cold outer reaches of the solar system. Perhaps the greatest surprise so far in the outer solar system is when the New Horizons probe passed by the Pluto system. Pluto and its moon, or really twin object, Charon, both showed evidence of cryovolcanic activity, with Charon sporting nearly a flawless new surface, suggesting geologically recent activity. Determining this is somewhat straightforward. If you look at the moon, you'll see both the effects of massive bombardment by comets and asteroids, but then also smooth areas of solidified lava, where the early craters were erased entirely or partially filled in. Charon shows this even more, where ancient bodies that haven't seen much, if any, volcanism only show abundant craters upon craters, a testament to how violent the early solar system was. Abundant evidence for past volcanism can also be seen on Mars. Indeed, Mars sports by far the largest volcano in the solar system, Olympus Mons, the top of which is so tall, at 25 kilometers high, that even during Mars's global dust storms, it can sometimes still be spotted summiting through. Compare this to Mount Everest here on Earth, which is just under 9 kilometers in height and isn't a volcano, or Mauna Kea, which is volcanic at just over 10 kilometers, rising from the sea floor. This leads to a couple of interesting mysteries specifically involving Olympus Mons. The first is that we may have rocks here on Earth that originated from this volcano. The volcano is marred by two impact craters that could in principle have lofted volcanic materials from the slopes of the volcano into space and ostensibly to Earth. And there is a match. There is a type of meteorite known as a shergotite that fits the bill here after a meteorite that fell in India in 1865, with similar meteorites found since. The Martian meteorites, of which the shergotites are the most numerous class, have a suspected Martian origin because of the chemicals they contain. There are literally bubbles of gas inside these volcanic basaltic type rocks that match the Martian atmosphere perfectly, but nowhere else in the solar system. The volcanic nature of these rocks also fits the environs of Olympus Mons quite well, based on evidence from probes. But there are other candidate volcanoes on Mars that could have produced similar materials. But there's a rather vexing problem here. While the meteorites in this class match Mars in composition, both for the stone itself and the gases trapped inside, on their face they seem to be very young, some samples of which appear to have crystallized only about 180 million years ago. This is known as the shergotite age paradox, and implies that either volcanism on Mars lasted far later than most of the surface shows, or how we measure the age of these meteorites is flawed and is giving a false answer. No one knows which it is. And the shergotites aren't the only mysterious volcanic meteorites linked to Mars as their origin. Another far more rare class are the nocolites, after a meteorite that fell in Egypt in the early 20th century. These types of meteorites are also igneous in nature, and there are some ideas of their origin points on the surface of Mars. But what's noteworthy is that these meteorites are much older than the shergotites. Rather, they are over a billion years old, much more consistent with what we know of Martian volcanism. But there's an interesting feature. At around 620 million years ago, these meteorites are shown to have been saturated by liquid water while on the Martian surface. They then dried out with the planet and were blasted off the surface about 10 million years ago, and have only recently made it to Earth and started falling here. And this leads to another great mystery involving Mars and its volcanoes. When did they go extinct? Well, the reality is that while most of Mars's volcanism is ancient, having happened billions of years ago, it may still be active today in some form, with significant volcanism having happened relatively recently in geologic history, about 500 million years ago or less. This is one of those issues where our probes have given us some insight, but our focus has been on the action of liquid water on Mars, so the study of its volcanism hasn't been as focused, and it may still be going on. It pays to remember here that we have never detected a volcanic eruption on Mars, and that's extended to studying the possibility of hotspots that might be detectable, but none have been found. At the same time, however, there are features on Mars that are of volcanic origin, and like the meteorites, look pretty recent on their face. In fact, one feature looks extremely geologically recent, as young as 2 million years old, but up to 10 or more million years, well within the time frame of the meteoritic evidence. So it may be a case where Mars still does have active volcanism, but it's very limited these days. The more recent evidence suggests some kind of volcanic activity as little as 53,000 years ago. That's within human prehistory, and if there was volcanic activity on Mars that short of a time ago, it's still happening in some capacity. And that gets us into the action of volcanism and water. Here on Earth, hot rock below the surface of a volcano or any hotspot such as Yellowstone can provide heat for geysers and steam explosions. Yellowstone shows this clearly with its geysers, but Mount St. Helens in Washington State is rather well known for steam explosions, where water meets hot rock and flashes into steam. And these events are sufficiently large to register clearly on seismographs. But the question here is that can that happen on Mars, and do we need to be careful just where we found colonies on that world? The answer seems to be yes. Mars has lots of water ice below its surface, and even liquid water in aquifers and other such conditions. This opens up the same water and hot rock interactions that happen here on Earth, from steam explosions to even lahars, where flowing mud can move down a slope and cause some serious havoc. There seems to be at least some preliminary evidence that shows that this has happened on Mars. And there is also evidence for features that may be the result of steam explosions on the surface of Mars. There's even evidence of situations where a volcanic eruption under subsurface ice can create telltale landforms that are seen both on Earth and something like them on Mars. The point is, Mars may still be significantly volcanically active. And like Earth, don't build your city on or near a volcano, as Pompeii showed 2,000 years ago, and Vesuvius is still a problem to this day, and Seattle is in danger from looming Mount Rainier. But at the same time, we do live on a more volcanically active planet than Mars. Mars doesn't seem very capable anymore of producing volcanic eruptions on level with Earth, but in many ways, we have a very similarly sized planet in the solar system under some of the same conditions as Earth. This is Venus. Venus and Earth are often called twin planets, but they really aren't, both atmospherically and geologically. Venus shows itself to at least once have been one of the most volcanic bodies in the solar system, beating all other planets in the sheer number of volcanoes. And it shows, Venus's surface is mostly made up of basalt lava plains. More, the surface shows itself to be relatively low in cratering, meaning that it must have essentially entirely resurfaced itself through volcanic events as recently as 500 million years ago, with evidence of recent volcanism going back about 2.5 million years. But then everything seems to have stopped, or maybe it hasn't and we just haven't seen it. The problem with studying Venus's volcanoes is that the atmosphere of that planet is so thick and opaque, the only way you can do it is through radar. This has been done to some resolution, but it's unclear whether Venus has any currently active volcanoes. Some clues point towards it being active still, including a recent-looking ash plain near its largest volcano, and other hints that there may be current activity. But this is debated, and more data is needed. But given the extensive evidence of massive lava flows, it would not be surprising. Volcanism on Venus is somewhat different from Earth in that Venus has no tectonic plates or the action of water, somewhat limiting what types of volcanoes exist there, particularly in regards to shield-type volcanoes. Oddly, the key to answering this question of whether Venus still has active volcanoes might come from lightning. There is some evidence from the Venera probes that Venus has extensive lightning that could be related to volcanism, as sometimes happens here on Earth. Lightning is in principle detectable, and one current mission to Venus is searching for it. But herein lies a question. If Martian and Venusian volcanism has persisted far longer than we used to think, then what of the moon? On this front, the moon has always been seen as long dead and solidified, but recent evidence shows that volcanism on the moon may have persisted far longer than had been previously imagined. The results come from China's Chang'e 5 probe that returned samples from the moon's Oceanus Procellarum region. This region again shows little cratering in comparison to the rest of the moon, leading to suspicions that this particular lava plain was younger. The sample showed that the material was a billion years younger than anything else that had ever been returned from the moon. This is puzzling, because everything else we know about the moon points to volcanism having ended by this time, so something must have kept this specific area unusually warm for a longer period of time. This is thought to be due to radioactive decay of some sort, which is the natural go-to for heat generation in this case, but the problem is that the samples don't show concentrations of those materials any different from the other samples collected by the US and the Soviets. So in the end, whatever kept this area of the moon volcanically active for so long remains a complete mystery. Yet even that doesn't appear to have been the end of volcanism on the moon. More recent evidence shows that very small-scale volcanism may have persisted as little as 50 million years ago due to observations done by the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, but was nothing on the scale of the huge volcanic events that formed the lunar plains billions of years ago, which seems to have stopped about 1 billion years ago in general. And even today, while there are no active volcanoes on the moon, the moon's mantle does appear to be warmer than previous estimates, and might even allow for pockets of magma to still be persisting deep under the surface. And this brings us to another moon that remains visibly very active to this day. It's wildly volcanic Io, and due to a lack of a thick atmosphere, we've seen these volcanoes erupting in real time. Io's volcanism is easy to explain. That moon is being flexed by Jupiter to the point of keeping its interior molten and its surface very active. Being near Jupiter is a high-gravity environment. The odd thing about Io, however, is that while it would seem inhospitable for any hint of life, it actually is on the list of potential life-harboring moons. It's a long shot, but the reality is that Io started out with just as much water as the other Galilean moons, including Europa. Most of that water is long gone, but it's unclear whether any of it might have persisted subsurface. And there was a period where liquid water might have existed long term, thereby opening up the possibility of microbial life. Whether that life might still be there surviving in some capacity in the moist environment of a subsurface lava tube is an open question, one that is likely to remain unanswered for a very long time, as Io would be one of the more high-risk and dangerous bodies in the solar system for humans to try to land on. But there is another volcanic environment left in the solar system that remains almost entirely unexplored and mysterious because it would have been very different from anything else. It's long been known that pieces of iron fall from the sky in the form of iron meteorites. In Earth's reactive environment, iron quickly turns to rust, leaving us with very little actual free native iron, though it does occur very limitedly in the form of native or telluric iron. But most of it we must smelt, though we've done that for thousands of years. But meteoritic iron has also been used in fall zones, such as Namibia, where the Nama people have worked fragments of the Gibeon iron meteorite into tools and weapons for centuries. This naturally led to speculation that there are iron asteroids out there, in the form of fragments of protoplanetary cores, or crystallized iron-nickel alloys formed during the cooling of these bodies, only to be blown apart by impact later. So the question is, are there iron-rich asteroids we could detect? The answer is yes, most specifically in the form of the asteroid 16 Psyche, which shows evidence of very high concentrations of surface metals. The problem is that it's not a perfect match. Its overall density seems to suggest that it's not wholly metallic, and that it just has metal on its surface and in its core. The explanation for this could be something called ferrovolcanism, where iron lava spills out onto the surface of an asteroid early in its history, only then to solidify and form highly reflective areas on the surface of the asteroid. Iron lava can differentiate from normal silicate lava in such an environment and be driven up onto the surface. We actually see a type of meteorite known as a pallasite that may show this kind of differentiation, where often beautiful crystals of olivine differentiate from a matrix of iron and nickel. This is a type of rock we don't really have an analog on the surface of the Earth. It's unique to the conditions that formed it, which are largely still a mystery. But in regards to 16 Psyche, it may exhibit and explain this kind of material, and there are many other questions, and whatever happened to this asteroid is not yet well understood, but we're soon to hopefully find out. Launching this year, hopefully, is NASA's Psyche mission to this asteroid on a huge Falcon Heavy slated for August that will investigate the properties of this asteroid and try to work out exactly what's going on with it, and how it relates to planetary cores, pallasites, iron meteorites, and much else. I think it's safe to say that while it will answer some questions, it will also create new ones. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently answering a question from the comments. When was the last time I took a break from thinking about existential threats like crater-forming iron meteorite impacts and alien invasions? It was 1976 when I took a break for teething. I remember it fondly. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.